just playing the music now, yeah. How's this? Alright, should we go ahead and do this thing? Awesome.
What is...
Sweet, Kyle, what's going on? Welcome to the fourth episode of the Alex Kendrick Show.
For those of you that are catching us right from the beginning, Kyle, what's going on, man? How are you? Are you stoked?
Yeah, certainly. I recently just got a new computer too, but I'm gonna have to do some crazy upgrades. I'm just kind of waiting for it to go into the shop. That's not really an essential thing. Just kind of waiting on all this to pass so I can do some upgrades on some stuff myself right now.
But we have a big one today. We have John Goblikon, as you know, we've spent a summer with that man, and I've been all over him. I'm pretty excited to see what he has to say.
You know,
wonder what he's up to. You know,
I was told that you were getting a bit of an echo, and that's why we take these few minutes to kink it out, you know, live. It's showbiz. But I think we're pretty much good now. Someone said they don't hear you.
Oh, they can hear me now. We're good.
Yeah. Kyle, you are good, I think, now.
Yep, we're all set now. I was muted. That'll do it.
Awesome. See, you know, just it's just a couple things. It's the small things in life, you know. We also have Joe Rudd, or I hope I'm getting the last name on that right. Rudd. It's one of the two. We'll figure out here in a minute. But as most people may know him as WWE superstar, or I guess as weird as this week, as former WWE superstar Eric Rowan. So yeah. I'm actually very excited to hear what he has to say about all this, and hear exactly how it's impacting the wrestling industry outside of just our music industry, you know, because being in Europe, like, we were on a bus and scrambling to get back to our respected homes was pretty difficult.
Yeah, that was rough. Know?
So I'm really curious to hear what they have to say with all of this and going on.
What's John doing with his time during this pandemic?
That's another thing I've been guessing or like wondering.
Oh, we got a frozen Alex. Good old, let's see what's going on here.
Error.
Oh, you're back. There we are.
Are we back?
I think we're back. I think we're back.
That got scary. Okay.
Too many people on the internet at once, man. Everybody's at home.
Yeah, I guess so. Wow, that made my brain kind of freeze out. That's what happens when you go live, right?
Can't edit it out, man. Can't edit in post.
No, it's kind of nice because there's no post. Let's just cut the weight. Should we go ahead and have the guys?
Let's bring them on in. Yeah, let's get them in.
Cool. Well, coming up, we have, this is crazy, former WWE Tag Team Champion on SmackDown, NXT Champion, Tag Team Champion. That's crazy. We have a big show tonight.
Wait a second and get them in here.
Gonna be a fun one.
Let's see. Well, let me see if I can add him in. Oh,
yeah,
there
let's
we go.
Do that. How's it going, Joe?
Well, it's going good, man.
Good deal. It's great to have you on the show.
You got some cats, some real big cats behind you.
Yeah, you know, with all the documentaries on Netflix recently, I figured I might as well pick a couple up.
There he is.
Oh, God. Who do we have? John.
Am I doing it?
You're doing it.
John, is that you?
Jared, where'd he go? I don't know how to do this.
Is Jerry with you?
Yeah, I got him duct taped over in the corner. We've been quarantining together. But he's a little too lippy for my liking, so he's in timeout.
Okay. So what if... Okay, so we don't have Jerry today. He's just in the corner. Good to know. Sorry, Jerry. In the corner. No, that's okay. All right, well, this is all so much at once. It's a pleasure to have both of you on the show. This is the first ever Goblin on the show, and I think maybe the only one we'll have.
There we go, you know. I'll spread the word either way.
Yeah, I'm sure there's, you know, a huge demographic of goblin viewers. And we also have a, I guess, as of this week, which we'll get into, a former WWE superstar, Eric Rowan. But we're going to go ahead and go Joe. Joe, how do you get your last name? Is it Rudd? Rude?
Rude.
All right, Joseph Rude. It's an honor to have you on. Thank you so much for being here with us. I'm just going to go ahead and kind of dive right in. As of this week, I did notice the WWE releasing about 30 superstars, producers, and a ref, if I recall correct. What can you tell us about that, or what exactly what that's like, and is that due to COVID-19?
I mean, if you look at Mr. Goblin's shirt, it is due to COVID-19, and there's no question mark to it. It's due to COVID-19. Are you alone right now, Goblin?
Well, see, here's the thing is, I've been quarantining, you know what I mean? First off, Goblin's very susceptible. You know, it's like old people, Goblin. So, I'm not taking any chances. I've been social distancing. You know, hashtag quarantining, hashtag social distancing.
And, I don't think you can get it through the phone.
Oh, that's where you may be wrong. We don't know that yet. So I'm not taking any chances. You know what I mean?
Does this answer the age-old question of if are goblins immune to coronavirus? Are you susceptible to the virus?
Oh, yeah, we're probably the most at risk. You know what I mean? The government's not telling you that, but we are at risk, my friend. See, you know who got it figured out? Way ahead of the time? Slipknot. Slipknot. I mean, think about it. They've been wearing masks for years.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and when was the last time you heard about them getting the coronavirus?
Exactly. Or anything. You know what I mean? I think they're all immune to it. Way ahead of their time.
It's not a bad...
About what's going on with this big fella. I tell you what. I heard the news, and I was immediately upset for you. You know what I mean? First off, let's talk about that. WWE. I mean, they keep changing their name. It was like F. Then it was like G. I mean, what's next? WWG? Oh, man.
I mean, this is all going full circle right now. Because we got Joe Exotic little stuffed animals back there in the old WWF World Wildlife Fund. What did they do to help the animals anyway? They just stole the name.
That's all they did.
You make good points.
John comes from a good place.
Man, I gotta know. I got no teeth,
pretty smart goblin.
I do what I can.
You know, a lot of people, especially at the venues on tour, like to undermine John because they just see, you know, a goblin coming into their clubs every day. And we really try and, you know, have him, you know, because they get kind of scared seeing someone like John just walking into the clubs, you know.
I get all the looks.
I don't know what it is.
It's not fair.
I take it you don't leave the house at all then for the stay-at-home and quarantine orders. You don't go get groceries. You don't dare risk it outside.
I have a gift card at Chili's. I get delivery. I get Southwestern egg roll set every day. I give one to Jerry and I take 11. And, you know, that's how I'm surviving. Basically that and White Claws. That's it. That's all I have.
What's your favorite White Claw flavor?
What's that?
What's your favorite White Claw flavor, John?
I dabble in berry. You know, it depends on what kind of mood I'm in. Lately, I'm like mango, you know, trying to pretend like I'm on some island, remembering the good old days when we were allowed to leave.
Yeah, where is one of your favorite vacation spots as a goblin? You know, do you have to watch out for excessive amounts of sun, you know?
Well, you know, this guy knows what I'm talking about, you know, bald life, hashtag bald life. You know, we got to be very careful in the sun, you know, and they don't make an SPF for green, you know. They try and stay out of the sun. I'm more of a night owl. That's why I wear these sunglasses. It's a little too bright in this storage unit that NecroGobblecon put me in.
Well, I mean, it's better than, you know, the last time when we left you in Europe. It's better than that.
I appreciate that. This guy, every time I'm on tour, I'm always like, can I sleep in the van tonight? And they're like, no, Alex says he's got to have a bug. I'm like, all right, I guess so. Can you believe they treat a sound guy better than me? I mean, it ain't him up here. You know what I mean? He ain't paying the bills. But yet it's me sleeping on the roof of the van or back in the trailer.
They don't put you underneath?
Sometimes they do. I don't mind it up down there. You know, the hum of the bus kind of lulls you to sleep, you know? The lack of oxygen kind of puts you out regardless. So it's not too bad.
It's effective in my mind.
Yeah, but enough goblin talk. I want to hear the juicy deeds about what's going on with WWG.
Yeah. Let's do some wrestling talk here for a second. What do you what's the move for you currently? I'm sure a lot of people are wondering. Are you thinking there's going to be a re-sign period after all this? Are you going to look for, you know, future work elsewhere?
I mean, the first move in any situation such as this is to raise a glass and have a drink.
Agreed.
Oh, I will cheers you there.
And it gives you power to make your next decision.
All right. We'll start. What are you sipping on there? You want to give us a...
I'm a big Irish whiskey fan.
I mean, oh, very tell.
Well. And it just goes down really smooth and, you know, makes you think, lets you think. So
yeah, certainly. Sometimes you have to really just take a sip and take a sip.
And during this quarantine, you have lots of time to think. And as of yesterday, I have a lot more time to think. So a little bit of drinking and a little bit of processing and everything in this world shut down. And it's absolutely nuts right now out there.
It's crazy. You know,
music industry, service industry. There's so many people affected by what's going on. People are losing their jobs and it's real, you know. And whatever you choose to believe about how bad this illness is, it's affecting people, whether, you know, someone's getting sick next to you or whether it's affecting your job. But all you can do is there's going to be another a day tomorrow and you just take one foot in front of the other and life throws things at you and you grab at it and you keep moving on. So whatever I decide to do next, you know, I don't know. Nothing's open. There's nowhere to wrestle
right now. Right, because you know, I know a lot of on the internet, a lot of people went immediately to the AEW book to see, they were speculating you going with Brody Lee or, you know, Harper as they have him now. But I've seen a lot of blogs already saying that, you know, and it's already so soon, you know, how could you?
Yeah, a very, very good man. Does he know much about Necrogoblicon's music or Mr. Goblin there? No, but very good man.
But you do. You do. I see you rocking the shirt. I mean, we share that, you know. Besides, like,
I wanted to wear the shirt that had the two middle fingers up, but you know, with sensors and the WWG, it just wouldn't work out.
Oh, I see.
You got to speak goblin language.
Oh, don't get me started on the sensors, my friend. They're always trying to stop me from saying what I want to say. What's on my goblin mind, you know? That's why Twitter exists. You know, we can just speak our mind.
So, can I ask you a question, Mr. Goblin?
Oh, yeah. Oh, please.
So, my first introduction to you was through a video I saw called No One Survives. And I'm just wondering, because that's very incriminating evidence of you mutilating a man. Did you ever get the lady?
Oh, well. It's a funny story that you asked that. You know, I did hypothetically, you know, tear the face off my boss's breast. But I'll say this. We live in Los Angeles, California. And they put Paris Hilton back together they could put Brad back together. They do amazing things out here with plastic surgery. So Brad's actually looking okay. He may or may not have passive-aggressively taken it out on me on a few different jobs and some strongly worded emails. But believe it or not, I did not end up with Caden Cross. But that doesn't mean I'm not trying, man. You know what I mean? I'm on a podcast now. I don't know if you ever heard of a podcast, Caden, but I'm on one. So that's got to up my street cred at least a little bit.
Yeah, who really won that battle?
And do you still have that office job?
I do. In fact, you know, I got news for you. I thought when this whole COVID thing happened that Brad was going to be like, don't worry about it. You know, we'll pay you vacation, whatever. Nope. I'm working from home. I'm on Zooms all the time. I'm Zooming all day, Zooming this. I can't be in all these meetings, listening to these people blab on. You know what they need on Zoom? They need a feature that just, you can play video of you nodding, you know? So you can just go grab a beer, and there's supposed to be a video of you like, uh-huh, very interesting, yep. And that's all it is. All day long.
I noticed you started to traject upwards a little bit on your sales. That's good. That's good. You've really turned your sales around.
See that at the job. Yeah, and sales are going really good. I mean, I'm good at my job. I know how to sell life insurance. There are two things that are certain. Progabalcon freaking rocks, and you're going to die. So you're going to need some life insurance at some point. You know what I mean? And that works every time. People buy it. And then they usually buy Welcome to Bonkers.
It's a good album. I definitely support that.
I move them in together. I was like, I'll do a little deal with you. You buy life insurance, and I'll give you a sweet discount on a couple of Necrogabalcon albums.
I love scotch.
I mean, you got me sold. Scotch. I don't know why we haven't talked about this before.
Well, it's because you may or may not have a, you know, on your back. I'm not going to say who, man, you know? So I don't think life insurance would be the best idea.
Oh, okay. Got you. A life advisor as well. Got you. Thank you, John. I'm a little disturbed.
I got a question for the big man. I got to ask, if you're all quarantined up, okay, how do you stay in shape? You know, what are you doing? What's the plan? Because I'll tell you what, closest thing I've done to working out is just eating a Peloton of snacks. Peloton of snacks. Anyways, just tell me how to work out, pal. I got to look good for the ladies.
See, I'm fortunate enough to have a friend that has a gym that I drive right past his house. He leaves the door open for me. I go inside, I work out, I scrub everything down, I leave. Don't even have to see him. It's great. But if you want to work out, why don't you just get down and give us some push-ups?
Nah.
I love Scott.
Yeah.
You want to get the lady? Scott.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think you should do it.
I think you should. Yeah. I think you should do it, John.
I think maybe just a jumping jack. Maybe just, let's just start out really slow. How about you just stand up out of the chair and then sit right back down? That is if you're wearing pants.
All right, I'm gonna try. All right. Here we go.
You can show up that Necrogoblicon COVID shirt.
You almost got it?
Whoa. Okay, great. All right.
All right, just start
slow. Maybe
tomorrow you get up all the way, and then you can sit right back down.
One day, man. One day.
If you think about it, if you do this enough, you may burn a calorie, too. You know, you're on the right track.
I'm into it. You know, if that's all it takes, trust me, I'm into it.
What do you think we'd have to do to turn this goblin into a professional wrestling superstar?
I mean, I saw the video, and I mean, you're killing, dude. So I think you got a chance. You got applause.
Yeah. I was hearing about wrestling gimmicks. What is a wrestling gimmick? Because at Necrogabalcon, I'm always trying to convince them that we need a gimmick. You know what I mean? We need like something like that people can really identify with it. We just don't have it. So what's a gimmick?
Alex, you want to answer that one for him, or should we give him a mirror?
Yeah, let's see. A gimmick, John, is something that you may have that would inspire other people to maybe catch on to this one certain topic about something, and it maybe it's catchy, and maybe they continue to go with it because it's got a real catchy, gimmicky kind of vibe, you know, something that you may repeat a couple times or something, you know, of that nature.
In wrestling, you had a gimmick, and your gimmick was that you had really good taste in music, correct? That's your gimmick.
If that's what you identified with, then that's the gimmick. Yes.
Oh, so then my gimmick is kind of being a sex symbol.
Huh.
Yeah, I'm just talking about what people identify with. You know what I mean?
You know, now that I'm looking at you, you kind of look like a green Rod Stewart.
I mean,
hey, there you go. What a compliment, right?
Great. I mean, I think he's a little bit older than I am. I think he's hitting 520, 526 in age, but the guy still goes.
I totally see it. I mean, he's got a little bit more hair, but.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if you suck. I gotta get a quarantine cut. You know what I mean? Everyone's cutting their own hair. I got to do that soon. I just don't trust Jerry with any scissors.
Yeah. It's, you know, I mean, I feel like he would be okay with scissors. You know, certainly it's got to have an easier time than you. I'm sure your fingers have a hard time with scissors.
Yeah, I mean, claws are hard, man. You know what I mean? It's hard to do anything in these things. Favorite wrestler of all time?
He's asking you, Alex.
Oh, me? Okay. I would have to go with a real easy for me, Undertaker. Growing up, that was just always, you know, a huge name in wrestling. And growing up, I had a wrestler at the time in my household who was, you know, wrestling around. I forget if I've told this story, but my mom used to date Marty Jannetty for a while. And that was about 5-ish years. So I kind of went with him to indie matches and stuff. Hey, I started watching that and stuff.
You know what I mean?
So, yeah, easy Undertaker for me.
I pulled in a lot of moms. You know what I mean? I got news for you. Wait, are you
How's your mom, son? John?
Are you his son?
Am I what?
He said.
No.
Oh.
No, I am not.
You missed out on that gravy train, huh?
Yeah. Who's your mom dating right now, John? Or is she happily married?
Well, she's been dead for quite some time. So, you know, she could be dating, I don't know, probably a lot of wrestlers.
Is that what you
think? I imagine so, you know what I mean? I had about 23 brothers and sisters. Large family.
Yeah. How's your family up? You're in Minnesota, right, Joe?
Yeah, I'm in Minnesota.
What's your family life like as far as just at home? You got a big family or just?
Oh, I got a lovely wife, a stepchild, and two kids I see every time I'm home for the most part. So, and now I get to see them a lot more. So it's. Actually, that's one of the blessings of this whole thing. I get to see my family.
That's what I was going to mention. That's probably something new. How often were you out? You know, I know they have you traveling a good bit.
I mean, usually it was between 4 to 25 days on the road. You know, like
right.
So it just fluctuated, but you know, never got more than a couple days at home at a time. So.
Yeah, and a lot of people know, you know, how, like, bands tour and, like, with vans or buses and stuff like that, but do you mind telling the people what it's like as a professional wrestler in the industry, how you travel about, you know, from gig to gig?
No, just you're an independent contractor, so you pay for your own hotels, you pay for your own car rentals, they pay for your airfare. So you go to a town, and then after you finish whatever gig you have that night, you yourself drive to the next town to a hotel you booked, you sleep in that hotel. So if I have to drive 4 or 5 hours after a show, I'm driving 4 or 5 hours after a show. I don't get to sleep in nice little bunks underneath the bus, you know, rocking, and a lot of the times, you know, you'll be driving solo and it's, you know, it's peaceful, but it's tiring. It's repetitive. It's Groundhog Day, but you know, wrestling is one of the funnest sports you can do. You know, no matter what level you're on, for me, like, I have fun doing it. And I'm sure, like, being on stage as a musician is the same way.
Certainly, yeah. I just enjoy the entertainment, even just from the production on my side of it. I enjoy mixing and just having a room full of people and just controlling, you know, kind of what they're hearing to a certain extent. You know, it's all about the entertainment in my mind. Ain't that right, John?
Oh, I have a great time. I love it. And secretly, you know, I'll just put it out there. I know that there's 30 slots open now. So, you know, if they're listening, I would wrestle. You know what I mean? I'm just saying.
I don't think it's the best time to try to get into wrestling until this whole COVID thing calms down. Just, you know, without fans, the shows really aren't the same.
Yeah.
What about this? You and me, tag team. We're now a tag team. What do you think about that?
Can I just tag you in until you gonna win?
Oh, John, do you even have a finisher yet, John?
You know, you can't kill the guy as a finisher. It actually has to be something where the guy can survive and continue on to fight the next day. Otherwise, there's no money in that.
Well, it's called No One Survives, because when it's done, no one survives. I mean, that's how it's
got
to be.
And I'm a little bit worried tagging with this guy because he's got those big giant claws. I put my hand out. I mean, you're gonna slash my artery in my wrist.
It honestly may be hard to take bumps with you, John.
Oh, we take bumps all the time on tour, man. We're just, you know.
No. I think we're talking about different bumps, John.
Oh.
I think we're talking about wrestling bumps.
Okay. Oh. I mean, a nose this big, I take a lot of bumps. You know what I mean? I'm famous now. People, you know. Something different. What bump are you talking about?
Well, in wrestling, there's something called a wrestling bump, where you may get shoved or dropped to the mat. You know, I'm sure Joe can give us some insight on a wrestling bump.
You ever slip and fall on some ice, Goblin?
Oh, all the time.
And you get the wind knocked out of you.
Yeah, it's the worst. It hurts.
That's a bump. That's a bump.
And that's what you do?
I mean, not too often. I'm barely off my feet.
No, thank you. Yeah, man. No, thank you. Actually, I tell you what. I've been following wrestling for a long time. I've been a big fan. You know what I mean? I mean, I know all the wrestlers. I know them all. You know, Ravishing Rick, the Snake, Hulk, Captain America. I know them all. But I got news for you. I think I misjudged you guys. You guys have it hard. Because I've been on tour. It's no fun. And then you're talking about bumps all the time. And you're an independent contractor. Man, you guys are the real deal. You're hustlers.
I mean, yeah, they're out there, you know, putting their bodies on the line every night. And, you know, as a man like this would know, a former champion, you really got to put your all out there when you're wrestling for the belt. Is that something you think you can do, John? Because I don't think it is.
Yeah, after listening to this, I don't think it is, to be honest. You know, I think I'm just meant for, like, TV fame, you know? sit in my chair, have them knock on my trailer and say, "Hey, we're ready for your close-up, John." I think that's more my style.
Yeah, you think after surgery 1, 2, 3, 4, or even 5, I would have just slowed down a little bit. But no, I just keep going.
Yeah, I was going to ask, what are some of the more gnarly injuries you've kind of received, or like what the harder ones to recover from?
So I've had the ACL torn. I've had both distal biceps torn. I had a low back herniation. I've had slight tears and of ligaments and fingers and shoulder tendons. But I think the worst injury I've had was I had my right rotator cuff. Very technical doctor term is super synaptus and infra. I can't even remember the name of it. Infra something. But yeah. You have four heads to your rotator cuff on your shoulder for a quick anatomy lesson, and two in the back had torn off the bone. So basically, I couldn't even lift up my arm. And I tried to work through it. It just didn't last too long. But yeah, we get hurt, and we just it's second nature to just keep going. I don't know why. I don't know if we're idiotic or if we're just passionate about what we do. I like to say we're just passionate about what we do, because I'll never admit I'm an idiot. will you ever admit you're an idiot, Mr. Goblin?
No, but I'll admit Jerry is. Jerry definitely is. You know, but just listen to you list all those injuries, man. I feel you. Touring is no joke. I mean, when I'm on stage, there's one time, oh my God, it's gruesome. You know, I was like going to grab the mic, and I grabbed it too hard with my claw, and then my nail was kind of like, it moved a little, and it was like hanging a little. I was like, oh God. So I know injuries, man. I feel you.
I don't think you can count that as an injury. That's just you got hurt. I mean, I've been hurt plenty of times. I think I'm still hurt right now. But man, you can't count that.
All right, well, I got to change my Wikipedia. Give me a second.
Have you ever broken anything, John? You know, got into a little scruff, a tussle anywhere, maybe leaving a bar?
Yeah. I broke Alex's guitar once. My bad. I said, my bad. Eric's drums one time. I was tripping. I was trying to play them. I went right through the drum head. So I broke those. Nikki actually still doesn't know that I actually bit through his cord, one of those XLRs. Actually, that might be your department. So, probably not sorry.
Well, that's good to know. We'll make sure we have that in mind before we start playing shows again next year.
2020.
Do they have insurance for this guy? I mean, did they have private insurance just for you? You sound like a walking calamity.
Actually, that's a good point. I should buy my own life insurance.
Yeah, I mean, I'm surprised you haven't sold yourself on it yet, John.
Maybe just some property insurance for the band?
Are you guys going to throw in Welcome to Bonkers?
I'm sure I can talk to the guys and have you, I'm sure we have one that, accidentally got cracked that we can, give to you.
All right, well, then you got a deal.
Well, that's good. What a glorious Friday it is. I will have a lovely sip of water to that.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Yeah. Oh, fireball.
Got some fireball,
The cinnamon.
It's very cinnamon. It's like I don't know, it was on sale at the liquor store. You know, essentially, the liquor store is still open and will never close. And there's talk in Minnesota of letting the restaurants that are hurting for business sell to-go alcohol.
They actually recently started doing that here in Georgia. Like, a lot of the Mexican restaurants and stuff are doing to-go margarita pitchers and stuff for takeaway.
I feel like it's helping the world go around.
Yeah, certainly.
I feel like everybody's drinking a little bit more. And it's not a problem.
Yeah.
But it's I think it just numbs people because he said it was Friday, and I was like, oh shit, it is Friday.
It is Friday.
You lose track of the days. I think I was watching the news this morning, and they were bringing up what day it was, and I had already forgotten what day it was.
You do, and see, that's kind of a beautiful thing, because
that's how much of a Groundhog Day this thing is.
Yeah, you know, and especially for someone that travels, you know, in, I guess, either industries between both of us, it's kind of hard to keep track of the days, and you're always, you know, tentative, because you know you have to be this place this time, hurry up and wait, so it's
kinda... Yeah, see, at home, you never thought you'd feel this way, but, like, when you're on the road, you take a flight back home, and then you're like, oh, what town did I fly out of to pick up my bags? I don't know what baggage claim to go to. I need to look up my ticket, because I totally forgot what town I just flew out of. Yeah, it's crazy that I'm feeling that right now at home.
Yeah, well, I'm awesome. We're sharing that experience with you. You know, it's honestly really nice. I haven't spent this much time home in what seems like years, and I've only been home a little over a month. But even just that 1 month seems to me like so long. You know.
But you're still going a little stir crazy.
Oh, you certainly.
You still want to get out. Because you're so used to and accustomed to just go. And that's exactly what I'm doing right now. I want to go do something. But
yeah, there's really not much.
What is there to do? So stay tuned.
Yeah, right?
Exactly.
Are you getting any good guests for your talk show right now? What's going on with that? I know you have a show of your own.
Yeah, I'm probably just gonna steal this footage and just cut you out, Alex, and then come back. But it's been hard, but I'm gonna try to start doing some stuff with, like, you know, Instagrams and Instagrams Live. You know, maybe get some people. There's been people blowing me up. I got news for you. That guy Jeff Buckley. You know, every time I die, Jeff Buckley. He been blowing me up. That guy's such a big fan of mine. And he's like, oh, I want to be on your talk show so bad again. I'm like, all right, calm down. So, you know, we might try and make something happen.
Wasn't that Andy Williams from Every Time I Die that you had on the show?
Oh, yeah, I love Andy. I interviewed Andy. I like Andy a lot. He's also a wrestler, I believe.
Yeah, he's over at AEW.
Is he really?
Well, he is.
Good for him to get out of that band with that monster. You know what I mean? That egomaniac. Buckley, man. Buckley's like, oh, gosh. Don't even get me started on Buckley, man. That guy, oh, wow. What an ego. I mean, I'll say this. They don't use his face on any shirts, but, you know, his head gets a little big.
I mean, the proof is in the pudding, and I mean... You are wearing a shirt with your face on it, so, you know, product sells. You have a profitable face, John.
And speaking of profits, I just want to say, I'm only promoting this right now because some of the profits are going to a good cause.
Oh, yeah, Save the Nomads, yes?
That's right, our buddies, all of our friends in the music industry, you know, people like Alex. I mean, we're not going to give any money to Alex, trust me, but people like him. Who work for bands, you know, what are they doing? What are the roadies of the world doing, you know? What are the road dogs of the world? Oh, that's a wrestling reference. Road dog, right?
I get it.
I know wrestling. Yeah, I know it.
Yeah, he's...
I'm tell by the end of this, you and I are going to be a tag team. You just wait. I tell you what.
I think you'd work out better as a manager, John.
I can do that now. Because
you'd be a great manager.
Because I'll tell you what. What's the name of Necro's manager?
Brett?
Yeah. McDuck, as we call him. I've seen how that guy manages, and it looks easy. You know? He basically just shows up to the show with two ladies on each arm, you know? Throws a bunch of money at us, tells me to dance, and then walks away. I can do that.
I think there's a little bit different in managing a metal band and managing a wrestler, though. I think there's a little...
Tell me, what do I do for a wrestler?
What would you need him out there doing, Joe?
I mean, you're really good at talking a lot, and it's annoying, you know? So, you know, I'm not really always the best, you know, guy. People don't really like me anyway. So I think if you're with me, they'd really hate me just because I'm associated with somebody that talks so much. So I think it'd be great for us to get together.
Yeah, that was about Alex, correct? You're talking about Alex?
I think he was talking to you, John. That was actually directed right to you.
Oh,
I mean, I never trust somebody I can't see their eyes, but you know, that's even better. It's the mystery.
Buddy, they're a little bloodshot. You know what I mean? I had to take the edge off before I got into this interview.
God. We've talked about that. We can't be doing another Dusseldorf, John.
So yes, you do a lot of talking. I think people would hate you because you would never shut up as a manager kind of situation.
Oh, part of the gimmick. The gimmick would be I talk too much. I get
the
it.
The gimmick could be you talk way too much. And as long as you got no problems, you know, taking a bump, and I'm not talking about the bumps that you're used to, then we'll be perfect.
All right. But so managers also have to get hurt?
Occasionally, right?
I mean, there might be a time where I accidentally punch you in the face, but that's only because the guy in front of me ducked. And I'm sorry about that. But yeah.
But I mean,
it better be a tag team.
Well, if we're a tag team, my whole body might collide into yours. That's even worse.
Oh, right. Yep.
Joe, sorry, is a big man, and you're a goblin. I don't know
what do you weigh, Mr. Goblin?
Oh, yeah, it depends. You know how much chilies I had. Give or take a couple egg rolls, I'd say, you know, upwards of 2, 3, 4, 5, you know, 80 pounds. 80? Probably 80.
80 is a good number.
Yeah.
All right. I got a couple hundred pounds on you. You know, give or take.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, you may have what it takes in the cruiserweight division if you do want to get into wrestling, John, but I really think you'd be better as a manager.
I think he'd be great as a manager.
I think you're right. I think my gimmick would be, you know, people pretend to hate me, you know, but secretly on the inside, they're like, but, you know, we're the biggest fans of John Novikov, so it's going to be pretty hard. It's going to be an upward battle, if you will, you know what I mean, to get people to hate me. But I think if I was playing a character and doing a gimmick, I think I could do it.
Yeah, just talk about how, you know, great you are and how bad everybody else is, how green skin rules and every other person sucks. It's great.
Oh, have you been reading my tweets? That's pretty much what I do.
Okay, so John, say you were going to manage Joe here. We got to hear a promo. How are you going to, you know, say someone's calling him out? What are you going to say back to him?
Oh, so they're calling him out. I'm defending him, right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, let me get into character. Well, let me tell you something, mister. My man over here, I know what you're thinking. Did I just turn on Duck Dynasty? No, it's not them. It's someone else. And he's the Bearded Wonder. By the way, I changed your name. You're now the Bearded Wonder. The Bearded Wonder is going to lay a whooping so bad that you'll have your... What was the name of that shoulder part that you injured? Remember your shoulder thing you're talking about?
Is this when you were talking over me and you couldn't understand what a rotator cuff was?
Yeah, that was it.
All right. Yeah.
You're going to need a new rotator cuff. Because he's going to rearrange it like Limp Bizkit. And that's probably it. You know what I mean? And
all right. Because you use a Limp Bizkit reference, I'm going to have to say I wouldn't want you as my manager.
Hey, I don't blame you. Yeah, we toured with them.
I'm sorry.
Wow, John. You lost it that quick.
That's all right. You know what this is turning into? Like, I smell a little feud. I think people would pay money to see us wrestle each other.
Anytime you want, John.
Are you sure you could do that, John? I mean, you remember, there's a big size difference.
Oh, it's not the size of the boat. You know what I mean? It's how many other people I get to wrestle for me.
I don't think that's a rule in a fight that's one-on-one.
Yeah, this is a sanctioned event, John.
You know, I thought we were doing good. We were having a fun conversation with Alex, and then you challenged me to a fight. And that irritates me. That pisses me the hell off, John.
Why would you, John?
I wish I could see you in the eyes right now so that everyone here would know how you tremble in fear.
Hey, Alex, I no longer feel safe, so I'm going to use our safe word that we talked about.
I don't think I can help you with this one, Sean.
Gimmick. Gimmick.
I don't think I can help you with this one. I think he's serious.
What's that, Jerry? I got a phone call? Oh, I'm so sorry. I got to take a phone call.
You're still here. I'm still having to look at your green face. Come on, man.
See?
There we go.
Well, now we've got.
Just had to humble him a little bit. Now we're good.
See, right. Now it's like you've been mentally, you know, you've had a mental bump now. You've been scared.
Now I know what a bump is.
Well, metaphorically.
Metaphorically.
It's. I don't think that's really how it works. You really have to hit the ropes. Have you ever hit the ropes, John?
I feel like this is some other weird metaphor, and probably. I mean, we've done a lot of weird stuff on tour, man. We've done a bumps, taking the rope.
I don't think we've ever been.
I want to hear this. What's the weirdest thing you've done on tour?
Yeah, dude. John.
Oh, man. Well, it's kind of hard to be weird when you're living life as a goblin. But one time, we were cruising down the street in a lowrider with a bunch of these nice gentlemen that were in a gang, and later that night, apparently, they initiated me. Just like that. So,
what did the initiation entail? Was it being beat up? Was it having to perform some sort of errand for them? What was it?
Oh, just because they're a gang, you assume that they resort to violence? No, we sat down. We played Settlers of Catan, and we had a great night. We really did. It was a blast.
I think you're forgetting Budapest, John. We had a pretty big rager there.
Hey, you told me when I came on this show there would be no weird tour stories. What happens in Budapest, Alex?
I mean, I'm just saying, you know, I'm not going to tell the story, but, you know.
Why would you do that to me? Why would you guys bring that up? That's horrible. Not just to me,
you gotta tell
it
now.
Why would you bring something up that happened in Budapest of all places?
Well,
and not tell the story. I think everybody wants to hear the story.
All right.
John,
well,
come on. Let him tell the story.
Can I tell the story, John?
Tell it, Alex. Tell it.
Okay. Well, we'll start right nice and, you know, dive right in. Our guitar player, Joe, has a nice, you know, prescription or whatever it is, the pills, you know, that say you're having, you know, feeling a little weak and you need to wake up the old bird, you know. Okay, now it's boner pills. Well, let's go straight in. You know, John, boner pills in Budapest right before the set. You got into Joe's boner pills. That one was wild.
I mean, listen.
Right before the set.
You guys told me the same thing every time I go on stage. Right before I go on stage, Alex, you point to me and you say, John, rock hard. And I
don't think that's what he meant.
That's what he meant. You know what I mean? I'm doing my job.
I think you took it overboard that night, you know? It's just, maybe not, you know, maybe. I just don't think we should do it every night, you know?
No, I was exhausted afterwards, trust me.
Yeah. Wow, John, that just kind of triggered me to a whole night of, you know, sadness.
You and me both, pal. That went to waste, by the way. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Really awkward night with just a bunch of dudes.
I mean, you know, it's weird because, you know, hungry, there's a lot going on. Have you picked up any instruments on this downtime, John? Maybe? We'll change the topic from boners, you know?
I mean, I've dabbled in the ivories.
Mm-hmm.
How about you guys? Playing music?
I can't say I have been. Do you play any instruments, Drew?
I used to play a little guitar, and I'm not great at all. But you guys talk about instruments, maybe I'll dust it off and try to strum a little bit. But no, not at all.
Yeah, it's not a bad idea on the downtime, you know? I mean, now as good a time as ever to pick up the old fiddle.
Actually, I was thinking about buying my son. There's a thing called Rocksmith. I guess it's like a... put it into like your Xbox and you learn how to play electric guitar through the Xbox. So maybe I'll buy that for him and play it with him.
Oh, wow.
Something to pass the time, a little father son bonding.
Hell yeah.
What if, Kyle, I kind of, haven't heard much from you. What's going on over there?
Enjoying everything.
There's a lot to take in at once right now, right? We've got a professional wrestling, you know, superstar and a goblin.
Kyle, you're just sitting back enjoying it.
Sitting back enjoying.
You're listening to the story about boner pills. You're just sitting back and enjoying it. All right,
taking in
all the
hard rock.
What was it like?
Go ahead.
What was it like when you met John last summer on the Summer Slaughter tour? I know we shared that tour together, and that was your first time meeting John.
I really enjoyed meeting with John and discussing what prop was going to be used on stage for that evening.
I found a couple
flower pots. There was a couple mops, I believe. John's very good with his props. Some of the best air guitar I've seen.
Oh, you're too kind. Too kind.
I mean, you are damn good at air guitar. You know, have you thought about taking that up, you know, professionally and maybe being a full-time air guitar player in a band?
I mean, look, Alex, when you're gifted at one thing, I suggest just going down that path. You know what I mean? Don't try to do too much. So air guitar is my thing, and I'm getting really good at it. And I'm like a virtuoso.
So this is my first time hearing that he's great at air guitar. Would you mind giving us a couple bars of your air guitar skills?
Joe, I thought you'd never ask. Sounds a little out of tune. My apologies. It's a little old, but here we go.
That's amazing.
You're welcome.
Wow.
It's all about having nimble fingers. If you don't have nimble fingers, you can't noodle on an air guitar.
I mean, the more you know, that's news to me.
More you know.
I'm going to dive back into another wrestling topic question with you here, Joe. What was your first WrestleMania experience like? Did you ever go as a fan?
No, actually, my first WrestleMania experience was about 4 weeks before I got called up to the main roster. It was WrestleMania 29, and I was one of the extras for The Undertaker's entrance.
Oh wow!
Nice.
I was one of the people in the, I was one of the people in the morph suits, moving their body fluidly.
And right.
So, Brody Lee was doing the same thing. Like, that was our introduction to the main roster. Was yeah, you guys are gonna put on these skin tight suits and just be animinous in the background. That was it was cool. Because Undertaker is a cool dude, so it's cool to be part of that.
Yeah, but, yeah,
that was my first introduction into WrestleMania and the whole production of it.
Yeah, it's really crazy to me that ended up getting moved to the Performance Center. What was it kind of like there towards the more recent bit? What was it like with the empty the empty Performance Center doing shows there? What was that like?
So I never got to do that. Last time I was seen on TV, I think the last week that there was a live audience.
Oh, that's true. And that was with the cage.
And that was, I think, in DC, and drew, killed the cage, which would have been a gimmick at the time, killed the cage gimmick. That was the last time I was, seen on television. So luckily I didn't have to perform in front of, no fans, which would have just been all sorts of weird to me.
Yeah, I imagine that's really have a mental wear and tear on the performer.
That's like going out and touring for concerts, but only performing in front of a camera. It's be kind of weird if you can't feed off the energy. Otherwise, you're just recording.
Certainly.
I can't speak firsthand on how all that stuff goes. I just know from other coworkers and people I know in the business that are performing for no people that it's definitely weird.
Yeah, I mean, especially it's huge for WrestleMania. That's history. It's never been done in front of no live audience.
No.
And with the production that goes into WrestleMania, that's huge. For people that don't know, that's what, 100,000 people in an arena, something with huge production,
It's, I like to say that this whole COVID thing's taken away everything I love to do. I love to wrestle in front of fans. I love to go to concerts, I love to go to the gym. That's all closed. I love to go out to bars with the wife, that's closed. So a lot of things I enjoy to do on my free time and just making a living, I can't do. And this whole quarantine thing, it's honestly an episode of the 1963 hit Twilight Zone. It's crazy. What you see, right now I'm sitting here with a goblin talking about crazy pandemic that's affecting the world. I mean, it's so hard to fathom. You turn on your TV and you're like, is this really happening? Because I don't see this ending anytime soon.
Yeah, it's not looking like there's any sort of end date near. Something I've asked a few of the guests in the previous episodes, what's the longest you think, this stuff could stick around? Obviously, indefinitely, but...
Well, I think on the news the other day, you heard a governor of California talking about how they don't want to have any big events publicly in California until 2021.
I mean, that's huge.
That's nuts. And it's keep extending the dates of when things will reopen. And it's how long can is it going to be until we can't reopen stuff because there's no money to reopen it.
It's exactly, and, it's a bit ridiculous because it's hitting, there's no industry that it's not really hitting, I guess maybe outside of booze. I'm sure the alcohol sales are going up around everywhere. But aside from that, it's everyone's for the most part out of a job unless you're, one of those essential workers.
And no one's in the streets picketing saying we want to get back to work right now, but like I could see that happening.
And certainly
right now we're all trying to take care of everybody and we're trying to be safe and not try to get people sick, but they don't know anything about this illness. Every day I hear something new about how it's transmitted, where it comes from. So I mean, is there going to be an end in sight? And if there is it going to be because something bad happens? And that's the scary thing in all this. And you don't know what to tell you. I got three kids at home that are all homeschooled right now. It's all remote learning. So we're all teachers right now too. And cause there's no school for them to go to. So they're trying to learn. It's like, what do you tell a kid? I have a 6-year-old. I have a 12-year-old and I have a soon to be 14-year-old. And it's like, I don't know what to say to him. And
yeah,
it's hard.
It's hard to be reassuring when things seem so discouraging, you know, just especially when it's covering the masses of everyone, you know,
especially when you don't have any answers as a parent, you know, and let alone a citizen of whatever state or government you're at the whim of.
How's it going in goblin politics, John? How's it hitting?
Yeah, I mean, that's what everyone's wondering, you know. Let's have the goblin weigh on the pandemic, you know. I don't know, man. I mean, I'm just living in a box that NecroGobblecon normally stores guitars in with Jerry. I'm social distancing. I have my gloves and my mask. And I just hope that sooner than later, I'll be rocking on stage for all the fans once again. That's it. That's all I want.
Maybe, you know, get the talk show going again. Maybe you could get some Skype internet shows going remotely during COVID, you know?
Yeah, just send me all that equipment, man. I'll do it tomorrow.
It'll be right over.
Yeah,
right over.
Right now.
Oh, I see what you did.
Yeah.
Right now.
Are those tigers back there because you like that guy, the Lion King?
Oh, yeah, the Lion King. Cheers, Joe.
Cheers.
I actually had a few people confusing Lion King and Tiger King this week. Have you seen that series yet, Joe? Tiger King?
Yeah, my wife, clued me into it, and we watched that together.
Once you see a couple episodes, it glues you in. How about you, John? Do you have cable in your box? Or do you have, you know, Netflix?
I just have the internet. So I'm waiting for it to come to the internet, and then I can watch it.
I think if you go to Netflix, you know, once you get the internet, it should be on the internet, you know, now, if you look on Netflix, John.
I normally watch it. Is it on Pornhub?
I'm sure there's a variant.
I'm sure
there's a variant.
I think I've seen that. That's the one I've seen. Yeah.
Tiger King.
Yeah. Everyone wins at the end.
Jeez.
I will weigh in. I have to ask, do you think Carol killed her husband? You think Carol Baskin killed her husband?
I mean, if I'm just going off of what the documentary...
Yeah, just solely off of observations.
I know nothing else, but the documentary makes her look pretty damn guilty. But the documentary also makes Joe Exotic look pretty damn guilty. So there's really no winning on this version. I mean, I don't know what version John's been watching, but
on
this version, I think everybody is guilty. On this version, except for one is in prison and one's not, but it's just what I saw.
Yeah, I kind of agree. You know, there's two sides to everything, but there's not really another logical answer that the documentary explains, in my opinion.
I think Carol came out and made a whole YouTube video, actually, kind of debunking everything from the documentary. I thought was pretty interesting, but I don't know. Still get the bad vibes. That's the way I feel about it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, John, you could take a trip down to Florida and pay Carol Baskin a visit. Maybe work on a tiger sanctuary.
I'm not too familiar, because the version I saw, she did do her husband, but then she had someone else do him as well, and then someone else did as well. So, you know, I don't know what she did to her husband. I know what a lot of other people did to her husband.
I forget that we've seen different versions of Tiger King. My apologies, John.
But, you know, hey, any opportunity to not go to Florida, I'm going to take it.
Well, you caught a good one there.
good point.
Looking up just some little fun facts earlier, Joe. It said in 2010 you participated in a Norwegian reality series called Alt for Norge. Is that true?
Yes, Alt for Norge. It was a reality show set in Norway. And since my family comes from a Norwegian lineage and emigrated here from Norway, I was eligible to be in a reality show, kind of like The Amazing Race, where you go back to a country that you have never visited before, but your family was from. And you compete in lots of different challenges, and the winner gets to meet your family from that country and get a cash prize. So that was a really cool thing to do and good opportunity. And I got to live in Norway for 3 months and see...
It's awesome.
You know, from the bottom of the coastline to the top Arctic part of Svalbard.
That's awesome.
There's a place out there that carries, it's like a seed vault in Svalbard. It's an island owned by Norway, up by the Arctic Circle. And in that island, they have every seed stored in a vault in case, like,
I think I've actually seen something on the internet about that. Yeah, they have every plant, every fruit, vegetable, just everything. Yeah.
That was fun. We did so many cool challenges. Like, we did dog sledding, you know, and having to dig up avalanche victims, you know, fishing with your bare hands out in aloft in islands in the sea. It was really cool. And, you know,
it sounds like a lot of hand-on experience.
Yeah, experience you can't buy either. And, you know, just life experiences that are unexpected, which is what my life has been, just unexpected things happening. So it keeps me optimistic about my future anyway. So just remembering things that I've done in the past, and, you know, and I'm still young, I'm 38. Like, no, I'm not 60. How old are you, Mr. Goblin?
What's that?
How old are you?
I'm in my early 30s.
Is he like 350 years old?
I mean, I think the early 30 part's right. I just think he's missing some other numbers somewhere in there.
Yeah. But I'm still young. I still got a lot to do and a lot I want to do. So just thinking about back at that show, like, and the experience I had doing that, like, there's so much more of the world to see. And, you know, that was just a small little 3 month part of my life. And there was so much I saw just in that small little, you know, period when I was there, and it was an experience of a lifetime. And, you know, hopefully more experiences like that come out to be.
Yeah, certainly. I want to ask, just from all the traveling, you know, it's really awesome getting able to see, you know, all sorts of ends of the world. What is one of the favorite places you've ever visited?
Favorite place I've ever visited?
Yeah. Wrestling or not, you know, just.
Ooh.
I mean, you can definitely name a few, you know, definitely not just top one, but.
Yeah. Me and my wife are in particular in New York City. We love it out there, especially Brooklyn. Like, it's great. Home to Duff's.
Duff's.
It feels like home when we're there, you know. With me and the wife, you know, we had a rule when I was on the road. I was not allowed to go to Duff's without her, because that was our place to be. So,
yeah.
But I'd say Iceland and Norway, Sweden, all the Scandinavian countries, Helsinki, Finland, like, they were all beautiful. I always made time to go out and look around that landscape. Maybe it's just because I felt like, you know, it felt like a home to me, just because of, you know, the culture and
certainly
that sort of thing. But like, honestly, I was becoming a big national park guy too. I was in Yosemite, and I went, you know, when I was on the road, me and the wife went out to Zion National Park. Like, I would always take time when I was on the road to go see things. And like,
yeah, that's something I try to do.
It's so beautiful. And you know, the world's got so much to offer, and we just live in a small little sliver of it. And there's places in Minnesota that I haven't even been to yet that are just stunning and beautiful. So it's like, it take 3-4 lifetimes to just see everything.
Yeah, certainly. I know one of my favorite, which I guess isn't a really landscape, but one of my favorite places in Minnesota, it's actually in Minneapolis, that Surly Brewing. It's my favorite brewery in the country.
See, I've never been there.
Yeah, you got to go check it out sometime.
I've had some of their beers, but I was sad. Told I had a gluten intolerance, so I kind of gave up beer for a little bit now. But I might have to stop there and try one when everything reopens.
Yeah, they have some primo food. I always get the best dinner. They're great steaks.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Go to the different ones across the country, and they didn't have chilies in Europe, but I love Europe. I tell you what, they'll be good. We had a chance there. I have a special spot in my heart for, you know, Chicago's fun. Out here, LA, the whiskey. Love playing that place. And,
the whiskey.
We've had some fun ones there. Come on. We really have.
Friends don't let friends play the whiskey at go-go.
Again, talk to Brett, because he booked us there a bunch of times.
What about Kyle? He got a favorite place?
Ooh, that's a tough one. Probably right off the top of my head, I'd say Tokyo, Japan. Big fan of Asia.
I've never actually made it over there.
I got to play a couple of shows there, which was pretty awesome, with my old band in Tokyo and Osaka. And definitely never forget that experience. Like, Europe was awesome, but that was definitely something else, playing Japan. So
I'll have to add that to my list. I mean, Tokyo was great. I lived out there for 3 months in 07 with the dojo. Yeah, so yeah, Japan is great. Hopefully I get to go back there someday too. I mean, that'll be another thing I'd like to do, some wrestling out there.
Oh yeah, doing some work with New Japan.
It doesn't matter what promotion, just to get out there. I love
Japan.
Yeah,
totally.
Japanese fans are the best.
Oh, 100%. What about you, John?
I see you over there making some reactions. Was there something you didn't like there, John?
Yeah, I'm upset that Necro GobbleCon has never toured in Asia. Sounds awesome. What's going on?
I don't know. You may have to talk to Jerry to talk to someone.
I'm sure they got a big following out in Malaysia, right?
Yeah.
That's technically Asia. Malaysia. You should go there.
Yeah, beautiful. I'll go anywhere, honestly. I'm just confused why we've played Bakersfield four times, but we haven't been to Asia.
Bakersfield.
What's going on here?
What's your hate on Bakersfield, John?
I don't have anything against Bakersfield. Don't get me wrong. We played it like four times. We're always in the middle of nowhere. It's like, let's go to Tokyo. Come on, guys.
Wait. So Bakersfield's in the middle of nowhere, so let's go to Tokyo, which is a flight to the middle of nowhere.
I thought it was like a cool place, though. Isn't it like all bright? And there's a bunch of lights and video games and stuff.
Video games.
Tell me I'm wrong.
Video games and anime.
You got the right gist of things. The right gist. And they got some fun videos for you to watch, because you were talking about that that Joe Exotic video you watched. So they got some interesting videos you can watch at the internet cafes there in Japan for you, John. I've heard.
Oh, you like cafes? I bet you love that, John.
I love the cafes in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
I just say, give me the stuff that's this color, please.
Yeah, well, you know, in Amsterdam, they'll do that for you. I don't think they'll do that in Tokyo.
No,
I don't think
so. The crazy thing is, you know, I don't want to say anything wrong about the people that live there. Well, let's just say they didn't bat an eye at me. You know, they just thought I was a local.
Oh, yeah. And where was this? Amsterdam?
Yeah, Amsterdam. Hmm.
You just blended right in, huh?
Yeah.
Do you have family there?
No, I don't have family overseas. I mean, I don't really have family that's still alive right now. It's kind of an only child now. I mean, it's just me and Jerry.
When did you meet Jerry? Because you've been with Jerry for some time now.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, we were grooming him to be our sound guy, but he doesn't always ask from a hole in a nap, you know? Yeah. And, it just didn't work out, so eventually he became my assistant. It's been about 6 years. And I guess he's my only friend.
Yeah. I think we can be friends, John.
Really?
I mean we've traveled a lot together, and you know, we've been all over the world, and you know,
I watched the door in the bathroom one time for you.
I don't mean to butt in or be a guy to cause friction between any people, but Alex, if you're really his friend, wouldn't you let him sleep on the bus? I mean, just one night.
I mean, come on, listen to the guy.
I'm trying to do you a favor, John.
I appreciate. Okay.
I mean, just know when to stay. Alex, just one night, one night on tour. Let the guy sleep in a bunk.
See, the thing is, we just don't like him to wear his stage clothes in bed, but he doesn't bring any other clothes, so we just ask that he has a separate pair of clothes for the bus, but he usually disregards that rule.
Oh, perfect peacemaker here. John, you heard it. You heard it first. Just bring an extra set of clothes, and then they'll let you sleep on the bus.
I'm hearing what you're saying, Joe. I'm hearing you. But Chili's sent me Chili's pajamas. And so I wear those on stage, and they're pajamas, so that I just wear them right to bed.
Convenience.
You know?
All right. It looks like you're going to be under the bus for a while.
I mean, I did try.
He is a friend. He just didn't make those sacrifices.
John, I know you've got some Bravado Spice shirts, too, to go along with those pajamas.
Yeah, I definitely do.
So you got to change of clothes right there. Nice.
Yeah.
I'm not taking the blazer on tour, man. I can't get, you know, blood, sweat, and tears on the Chili's jacket. This was custom made. This is red carpet material or a podcast, you know?
I mean, I see where you're coming from. I was just kind of giving you some insight on the whole bus thing, you know?
I appreciate it, Alex. You know, maybe next time on tour, you know, we can discuss it, and you and I can approach the band members and, you know, give it a shot.
I mean, if you're really up to it, we could probably even give you a band shirt.
Don't tell promises that you can't keep.
I mean, I think we have goblin sizes. You have one on now. I think we can work that out if you don't mind changing shirts on the next tour.
I mean, it's all this Necro Goblin guy.
Yeah. I think we can work that out. Just let me know what size.
XL.
Okay. That's just between you and me.
Yeah. Trust me. It's not in the front. It's more in the back. You know what I mean? It's more in the back.
The hard to reach spots.
Yeah.
Very fair.
You'll edit that out though, right?
Right. Oh, yeah. It's not live.
Yeah. John, you're good.
We're definitely not live, John.
All right. All right.
I didn't hear nothing.
Yeah, I mean, do you think you guys could swap roles, and I'm going to see the best impression that John has on Joe and Joe's best impression on John? Can we try that out? You guys look like you guys know each other pretty well already. I mean, we've been here a little while.
I think John's up.
Oh, John, you're up.
Let me see here. This is a beard. Just pretend this is a beard. Oh, you talk too much. I'm gonna beat you up. I'm a big, scary guy.
I think you. That's all you got, John? That's it?
I mean, I thought that was dead on.
Okay.
This was the voice. You know, all of them would have turned around and been like, who's this amazing impressionist? I don't know if they do that on that show. Can't they see the voice.
The voice.
I don't think it's that show.
I've heard of it.
That's not that show?
Some other show like that, but I don't think it's that one.
All right, let's see this John Gavacon impression.
Well, let's just see this John Gavacon impression. The guys, hi, John Goblin. Yeah, the Necro Gavacon, you stick all my shirts. Yeah! So,
wow.
I like chilies. I got this nice little blazer on. Yeah, how do I look? I look great. I'm wearing his glasses. I got the mask on. I'm feeling safe in this world right now. Oh, you watch that Pornhub? That Pornhub Joe Exotic? Oh, the Carol Baskin got with that one guy, and then he got with the other guy, and then she got with the other guy, and then they all lived happily ever after. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Alex always kicks me out of the bunks. He always kicks me out of the bunks and puts me downstairs. Mm-hmm. I got big ears. Mm-hmm. 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 John Goblin. That's my name. You hear that? It's Chili's. It's Chili's.
That was quality. That was perfect. John, you may have to watch out for your job.
I think Joe won the voice this round.
It would have been so much better had I had a goblin face. But I just don't got one.
Kinda felt like high school over again.
I don't know what that means.
I'm just saying, it's like,
elaborate.
My ears, you know what I mean? I'm self conscious now, Joe. I didn't know we were going for low blows, you know what I mean? I just kinda got my feelings hurt, that's all. No big deal.
Hey.
Nope, no, it's fine.
Here's to you.
No, it's fine. Yeah,
No ill will. No ill will.
It's not a big deal. I mean, no, it's fine.
You call me a big scary guy, and that's yeah, just not what I am. So you know what? I feel bad too. I feel real bad that you hurt me. You hurt me, John. Because I'm not a bad guy. I'm not just mean. Like when you look at me, all you see is a beard. That hurts my feelings. So let's have a drink to hurt feelings.
Okay.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. Cheers to that one.
Yeah.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Yeah.
John, have you tried growing a beard?
Cheers. Let me just get happy again. Hold on. All right. And my feelings are no longer hurt. What were you saying?
I was just wondering on how your quest on growing a beard has been going.
It's not very good. Goblins aren't really one for facial hair. Yeah, hair in our ears, back here, on our back, on our lower parts, but we don't really do facial hair.
Okay.
All right, you guys, I mean, how long did it take both of you to grow those?
I have a small beard. I trim mine. It's, you know, just a couple months. Looks like there's some years over there, though. How long did it take you, Joe?
No, man. I shaved a couple days ago. You know, I found out I was released. I shaved the whole beard, and it just happened to grow right back. You know, so I think it's just stuck with me.
You can't leave it.
And Kyle, how long have you just been an emoji? I mean,
it's ever since I went to Japan, John.
Oh, see, I gotta go there, man. Sounds awesome.
Is the emoji even close to what you look like, Kyle?
Relatively. Hopefully my forehead's not that big, but...
So you're in your early 20s?
Not quite. I'm close to the 30s. Closer to 30.
Yeah.
And well, do you have legs?
Emoji is pretty young.
My emoji does look young.
For those tuning in, Joe and John cannot see Kyle, so he's just the voice of God.
I am. Let's see. Yeah, let's pull up
John, here. I haven't seen you have one Southwestern egg roll this whole time.
Buddy, I'm waiting on my delivery. It's hard. That's what I'm saying. This COVID-19 stuff is the real deal. You know, I've already blown through all my snacks. So now I have one delivery a day from Chili's.
Are they responsive? Like, have you reached out to them and told them how much, you know, that you've been ordering Chili's?
I'm telling them. You know, I'm calling them. But it seems like they have bigger things at hand. I don't know.
What could be bigger than a goblin ordering Chili's in a Chili's suit?
I mean, that's what I'm saying, man. I'm blowing up their social media.
Yeah, you should.
Yeah.
You definitely should. Are you a Chili's fan, Joe?
You know, I try to avoid it every chance I get. I'm not really the biggest Chili fan. Actually, the only times I've been on the road to go to Chili's was when I got Callee duty. And Callee duty was, I would drive the great Callee around when he was employed with the company. Yes, and this is when I first started, you know, back in 2013 to 2014, and you would get Callee duty, which they would give you a free rental car, a free hotel. All you had to do was drive Callee around. And one of my favorite memories, it was he always loved to go to Chili's. So I think we were in Canada once, and I couldn't find a Chili's. Like there was nowhere. And then I finally found one. It was in a mall in Edmonton. Well, I didn't know Edmonton had the largest mall in America. So mall was so big, and finally I parked, but when we walked in I found out that we had to walk a long way to get to Chili's. And Callee, you know, I stick out pretty well myself, but Callee sticks out like a sore thumb, and he just had a crowd of people following him, and I just laughed.
Oh, I can imagine that, because I mean he's a tall guy. You're tall yourself, but he's what, 6'11", 7 foot, something like that? He's up there.
Oh, he's like 7'2", 7'3". He's taller than Big Show, and Big Show is barely 7 feet himself. And but yeah, just seeing him walking through to get to Chili's and just how happy he was sitting down. I've never had this egg roll you speak of. I think it was like a salmon with anchovy thing I had, and it was weird. And I think Call of Duty was the only time I ever went to Chili's. So John Goblin and the great Callee have one thing in common.
I love and admiration
for Chili's.
Yeah, I think we'd be friends.
Maybe you guys could tweet them together in a commercial. Maybe you should manage Callee.
Maybe that's your calling.
And speaking of which, I've already been playing Call of Duty.
Yeah,
he's pretty witty.
I love that game. I think we do really well.
I think we're on the right course, John.
Yeah.
What, have they ever been out of egg rolls, John? When you go in to get, you know, your egg rolls?
I call ahead, man. You know what I mean?
Oh.
I'm a pro. That's some rookie shit you're talking about. I call ahead and I go, get them firing, boys. JG's on the way. And they know. They know that means at least 24 right in the fryer. That's course one. Then I, ingest a couple of margaritas. And then, order maybe like a sizzling fajita. See, the problem, Joe, is you just didn't order the right stuff, man. I'm going to take you to Chili's. Next time you're in town, you and me, we're going to Chili's.
Oh, please.
I'm going to show you a good time. Bring old Collie Beauty. The three of us, they got trivia on the table. We'll play some trivia, and we'll eat some Southwestern egg rolls.
Wait, trivia at the table? They got that?
Oh, yeah, man. I'm telling you, it's the greatest place on earth.
They stole that from Applebee's, right?
We don't mention the A word here. Sponsor, you know.
You don't want the monster to come out from the A word. Yeah.
Oh, no.
I noticed you have some gaming equipment there behind you, some pinball.
I got three kids. I mean,
yeah. You know. Do you have a collection going of pinball?
No, we got the Nightmare on Elm Street pinball behind me, and
that's awesome.
Just a couple cabinet arcades.
Nice. What kind of cabinets?
Yeah,
what kind of cabinets?
Yeah.
Oh, I actually got to turn and look. A Legends Ultimate, so it's got like a bunch of different, like the old school games. And then one of the arcade one-ups, which
awesome.
Cheap. It's got Asteroids, Mystical Man, all the stuff you need.
Those are
all
fun.
The stuff from your childhood. Yeah.
You been playing any games there, John? Outside of Call of Duty?
Candy Crush. I love my Candy Crush.
Yeah, it's a Candy Crush.
Oh yeah, I love it. I love it.
Yeah, what level are you on about?
The high score is probably what it is, you know.
Yeah, I mean that's got to be you, right?
Yeah. It's got it.
GG. Just racking up the score.
That's me, man. These are the real deal. I think these are 500. I don't know.
Alright, just be careful. Yeah, be careful. Hey, Can't have too many. Be bad in the liver.
Yeah, I need to just take the edge off. You know what I mean? All day.
It's been a rough.
Jerry and I'm in a storage unit. You know, it's a hard life. It's also hot in here.
What state are you in?
I'm in Van Nuys, California. Where all goblins are.
It's goblin.
I mean,
central, eh?
It's the headquarters.
Yeah, we're all in the valley. We're valley boys.
Oh.
So what I'm hearing is next time that Joe is in the LA area, you guys are gonna go get some Chili's.
My treat.
Well, let's hope Chili's are open for business.
Yeah.
Buddy, I tell them Joe and JG and Collie Duty's coming, they'll open it up. I promise you. We'll tell them we'll all stay like Collie away from each other, you know?
That's true social distancing.
Yeah.
And I think you may be onto something.
Alex, what am I getting myself into?
I don't know, man. You're into the goblin world now. It's a whole nother world over here.
You got a sister?
Me? John. Nope, not anymore.
You got a girlfriend?
Working on it. You know, I could by the time we go to Chili's. I could text some you know, girls. Alex.
Any other sibling, brother?
Just me, man. I'm all by myself out here.
No parents.
Nope.
No kids.
Nope.
Have you thought about having kids, John?
I mean, I would think about it. I mean, they're delicious.
Yeah.
All right, you're not allowed in my house, John.
You certainly. I wouldn't. I tell you what, like, I wouldn't be hungry right now if I had kids. No, that'd be a really nice quarantine.
All right, better question. Well, did you have kids, John?
Not that I know of.
Okay.
Have you been on any reality TV shows that may say otherwise?
I don't think so.
It's a safe answer.
I was on a Norwegian reality show, though.
Oh, yeah. What was it called? What was it called?
Beards and Beers. Beards and Beers.
Beards and Beers.
Yeah.
What kind of beard, John?
Beer?
You don't got a beard, so...
Oh, right. No, no.
What kind of beard?
No, I know all about beer, man. I like micro brews. I like Michelob Ultra. Beer. You guys ever had that? Michelob Ultra?
Tell us about some of your favorite craft beer, John. Yeah.
That's one of them. You know what I mean? Michelob Ultra. I like Bud Ice. You know?
Yeah.
That's a really good one. You know that there's a Necro Goblin beer?
You know, surprisingly enough, I haven't had that.
Oh, no, I've not had that either.
Our buddy, shout out to Nick. He makes incredible Necro Goblin beer. They're really good. Really good. That's my favorite.
So that's a microbrew, and he's from Van Nuys. There's a great new Netflix show called Bruise Brothers. Have you seen that?
Bruise Brothers.
Have you seen that? Bruise Brothers. And it's about a couple brothers who make a brewery, a microbrewery in Venice.
Where did we watch this?
It's on Netflix. There's a plug. Have some fun. Binge watch.
I gotta get Netflix.
And while you're at it, watch The Tiger King.
You know how you are with binging, John. This should be a good one.
All right.
Hey, it's a binge that won't let you end up in a hospital bed. So it's a great binge.
All right. I'm gonna write that down. Binge Brothers.
Bruise Brothers. Let me slow it down. Binge Watch Bruise Brothers.
Right.
And it's on Netflix, just so you know.
Hey Siri, set a reminder, 9 p.m., watch the Blues Brothers. All right. We'll do.
Right, have fun with that.
That's going to be a real good one, John. I you know.
I appreciate
it. Go back. What was that, John?
I appreciate the recommendation. I do. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm going to go back to the wrestling topic again just for a second. You made your debut with FCW, correct?
For the WWE, or as John says, the WWG. Yes.
Yeah, and that ended up getting turned...
I was working, you know, on the independents before that.
When did you debut in the Indie League?
I started training in 2002, so 2003 in Minnesota.
Very nice. What were you doing in 2003, John?
I think that was probably... I just started working for Brad at the life insurance agency, and I had not yet met NecroGabblecon.
It was still the struggling days for you, as a hungry, starving goblin.
Yep.
Pre fame.
Yeah, pre internet fame. Yeah.
But back to you, Joe. What was one of the hardest things picking up professional wrestling for you? Was there any obstacle that really stood in the way when you were kind of, you know, I'll say mastering your craft?
No, so it's like the bumps and just moving and knowing where you are in the ring. It's just all the fundamentals, and then you put the pieces together. It's like an art form, and there's a lot to what we do. It's so much now, it comes so, you know, naturally with what I've been doing it so long, comes naturally what we do. So it's kind of hard to explain the nuances of what it is we do.
Right.
Just that you never stop learning. Like up to the last day I was out, you always learn something new, whether it's about like when you walk out to the ring and the television, you know, for a television production, you gotta know where all the cameras are. You have to know, like for a television product, you need to time cue. So you have to be, oh, we're going to commercial right at this time. So we need to get to a certain spot right at this moment in time.
Right.
So like, it's the coolest job you'll ever have, because like no 2 days are the same. It's like we don't just replay the same hit over and over again, I guess. We always do different things every day, which makes it exciting. As opposed to televised events. And live events are probably the closest you can get to like an independent show, because we can involve the fans a hell of a lot more than we can during a television event. I can scream at a fan, you know, I can roll out the ring and scream at a fan in his face and roll back into the ring and, you know, get punched in the face, and people will be happy I got punched in the face because I went out in the ring and screamed at the guy, and nobody wants to get yelled at. And you go back into the ring and you they're happy to see. So there's so many different nuances and stuff to what I do. It's the funnest job in the world, and we learn every day for your whole career. You never stop learning. You could have the last match when you're 80 years old and learn something from it. And that's what I love about it. And if you think you know everything in wrestling and you're a wrestler, you don't, and you have a huge ego, and you're probably never going to get any better.
If you were explaining to someone who's like very new into wrestling and doesn't quite, you know the grasp of it, kind of like what you were saying earlier about if you're going out to engage with a fan and yell at them, that's kind of marking the role of like a heel, you know? How would you describe like the roles of heel and babyface to someone if you're trying to explain that kind of
stuff? In layman's term, heels, you want fans to despise you, to look at you and boo and not want you to win the match based on what your actions are in the ring. So let's say there's an opponent in the ring and he's fighting you, and you do something behind the ref's back that's considered cheating within the sport, and the fans don't like that, but the ref didn't see it. So in hindsight, everybody's upset with that heel. That's healing. Just getting people to dislike you for some reason. And the opposite scent, baby facing, is people cheering that guy to win. They want this person to win. And let's say that bad guy is doing something to cheat, whatever, then the good guy has to overcome that. And if he's getting people to cheer him by doing things to that bad guy and beating the shit out of him, that's a good guy. But if they're booing the good guy and the bad guy, that's not fun. And that's why it's so weird to have wrestling right now just in front of nobody, because there's nothing to feed off of. So it's harder to gauge.
It's kind of hard to keep the
because wrestling is an art form. It's a sports-based dance. It's a fight. It's real. We get really hurt, but we got to wrestle every 300 days a year. So we're not giving each other black eyes every night if we can help it. Sometimes we can't help it, and our fist goes a half centimeter forward, and we punch a guy in the face, and we get a concussion or whatever, and we can't wrestle the next day, or we can, and we get a black eye. But if we did that every day, we would not be in good shape. So as far as wrestling in front of nobody, it's a lot harder to gauge, you know, the fans' Family. Response, and you feed off that energy too. So... interesting times, but as far as always, you're always learning and you're always, you know, trying to perfect your craft the best you can and evolve as a performer.
I've been reading a lot online, to where a lot of, you know, especially the wrestling blogs, they can get, you know, toxic in my opinion, but nonetheless, I've been seeing a lot of people that said they just wish everything froze, you know, and like they halted the storyline, they halted everything, and then just kind of rebooted a bit later. How do you think that would impact if, you know, something like that were to happen? Because I personally like that there's still some televised stuff going on and, you know, it keeps the ball rolling. What do you think would happen if, you know, it went into a shutdown?
If it went to a shutdown?
Yeah, what do you think would, you know, like what would happen there, do you think? You know, and just set it down, pick it up later?
I mean, we're in crazy times, so it could happen. As far as storylines, you know, they finished up with all their Mania stories and other, you know, AEW is trying to do a tournament. WWE is trying to do their build to Money in the Bank. So, like, everybody's trying to do business as usual to try to gain, you know, support and whatever. So hopefully the ratings start to get better for people and people will start tuning in as a new product to watch, because, you know, there's nothing to watch that's new right now. So hopefully the ratings reflect and people start watching wrestling right now. I don't know how much people are really watching it, you know, because, you know, there's so much Netflix and Disney Plus to watch.
Yeah, yeah. It's easy just to get locked in and, like we were saying earlier, just binge watch stuff like Tiger King. And.
But pretty soon that material's going to be stopped, and the only thing that's going to be filling is wrestling. So hopefully people start tuning in and it gives people an outlet to watch something on television that's new.
Yeah, certainly. Have you been tuning into any wrestling lately, John?
Oh, yeah. I told you I'm a big fan. I love wrestling.
What's, you know, tell us some of your favorite wrestling stories, John.
Watching wrestling?
Yeah, what's some of the craziest stuff you've seen? What's some of your favorite stuff from watching?
Okay, what? First off, I've been following this guy for a while. I remember back when, you remember when you used to wear a mask?
Yeah.
Remember that mask?
That goes back into the...
I had a few of them.
Yeah.
That goes back into the Wyatt brothers.
Like I got about 20 of them later on in the house. All different.
But like, you know what I mean? Like a grown man wearing a mask. It's a little embarrassing. You know what I mean?
Wait. Look right in the camera and say that. Like, I didn't hear you.
Yeah, but you say a grown man wearing a mask seems a little silly to me. Someone's got a gimmick. You know what I mean? Like, all right, we get it, pal. But now I'm glad that you realize that you don't need it. You know? You have a very nice face.
No. People just run away from me because they see the way I really look.
That's it, man. I mean, it's like, if you're as big as you, you don't need to hide behind a mask. And I think what's wrong with society is we're all metaphorically hiding behind a mask of some kind.
I think right now we're all hiding behind a mask.
Yeah.
I mean, case in point, look at this guy next to you. Oh, there you go. You're wearing a mask right now.
I mean, look at Kyle. He's not even he's hiding behind an emoji.
I think it's just you and me that can't see Kyle. I think everybody else can see Kyle. Is that correct?
They can, yeah. Yeah, they can see me.
Oh, the rest of the world can see Kyle.
Yes.
Well, I literally don't know what Kyle looks like other than a cartoon, you know?
So he looks about, like about the same.
I wish I could explain what this cartoon looked like to people. I wish you could take a little clip of this cartoon
that we're seeing. Can you put it back on here?
For one, to show people what we think you look like, because we have yet to see what you look like, and if that's what you look like, that's a really on point. Alex, is that what he looks like?
I think it's loosely an accurate representation.
Mm.
You look like a cartoon version of the lead singer for Nonpoint. am I wrong with that?
I see it a little bit. I see it now that you say that.
Yeah, that's a name I haven't heard in a while.
Oh, I see your emoji now, Kyle. Yeah, now the world can see what we think Kyle looks like.
Oh, that's good. I think it's pretty accurate.
Yeah.
I might have to go back and watch this just so I can see what Kyle really looks like. And if it's not accurate, I can call him the hell out. But if it is, I'd be like, oh, benefit of the doubt. You created that emoji, Kyle?
No, someone drew that for me a couple years back.
Okay. Somebody that's probably really close to you that, you know, cares about you and thinks that, you know, wants to boost your ego, or somebody that didn't like you.
Ah, might be the latter.
Love that. This is a new fun twist.
What an intriguing topic.
It's like Kyle, a cartoon.
It's like the old "Are You Afraid of the Dark" series, where it's like, okay, classic. What's this mystery we got here? All right, it's the mystery of the emoji. Is it or is it not? I don't know. All right, here's the tale of the emoji.
Oh man, I wish I had some Irish whiskey to take a shot of right about now.
Same.
I think I need to slow down.
I'm dry.
John, is your chilies on the way? It's still.
Actually, it says it's 2 minutes away, so I gotta get it in 2 minutes. I gotta be out of here. I got my chilies.
You know, I feel like we could probably make that happen. Is there anything you want to tell the world, John, before we come to this conclusion of epic meetups of Goblin and professional wrestler?
Well, I mean, I've had a great time. I've learned a lot. And I think I've made a friend. And certainly I can tell you that we're going to go to Chili's. That's going to happen, Joe. You just wait, Joe. And most importantly, I want people to be able to find me at John Gobblecon or at Real John Gobblecon, so I can keep in touch with them during this time, because I am lonely and bored.
It's a bad combo.
It's
bad for everybody.
Are you going to give any of Chili's Southwestern egg rolls to Jerry? Does he get to eat tonight?
I like to keep him on the wall, duct tape, and then...
Who's Jerry? Why am I
my assistant.
All right, you brought up Jerry numerous times. I just haven't thought of it in the nest. Because quite frankly, until now, I really haven't cared.
I mean, technically, we're roommates. Technically, we're roommates.
All right.
Are you living with him out of, you know, like, are you forcing him to stay with you?
No, I'm literally Scorpion from NecroGoblinCon opened up the storage unit and said, hey, look, you and Jerry should go in there, and there's something in the back there. We started walking. We heard it close. Then we heard a bunch of locks. And that was about 4 weeks ago.
Well, looks like you landed on your feet.
I always do, pal. I always do.
Thank you a lot for spending some time with us, John.
Yes, thank you, John.
I know you've got busy days over there with your sales and life insurance and Brad up your ass.
All day, every day.
Hey, John, can you play us out with a couple bars of your famous air guitar skills?
I sure will, Joe. New best friend, Joe. Chili's buddy, Joe. I'm ready for you, pal. We're best buds, I tell you what. I'm gonna write you a song. This one for Joe. And that's it. All right, gentlemen.
That's all we get.
So,
John.
Hey, Alex.
Yes.
When is this going to be edited? And where you just take all my funny jokes and put them into one and then release?
We'll have that up. It should be, honestly, by the time the end of the COVID-19 ban. So just bear with me for what could be a few months or maybe the end of the year. I don't know. But we'll have it, you know, edited and shot up, and we'll have it right over to your people. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
All right. And just, if you could, just kind of Photoshop. Got a couple spots, you know. Been eating a lot of spaghetti.
Yeah, yeah. We'll make sure our people are on top of that.
All right. I appreciate it. All right, Kyle. Get a body, you know. All right.
I'll do that next time, John. Later. Just for you.
All right. Adios, mio.
Bye-bye, JG.
Oh, poor JG. Well, I want to thank you again for being here with us, Joe.
I was really hoping once he left the call that I'd be able to see Kyle. I'm very, very upset that I can't see Kyle right now.
I wish I could enable it.
I'm trying to figure out a way. I don't think there is a way.
You know, it's very technical savvy. I'm sure JG would have helped in a situation like this, you know, considering he's got so much free time on his hands.
Yeah, I don't imagine he's up to too much. I just wanted to ask a couple quick wrestling topic questions before we take up too much of your valuable time while we have you here. What was your first championship like once being on the main roster? Tag team, of course. What was that like? How did you feel?
So it was really cool considering that we were in NXT, which wasn't correct. Was considered developmental back then. We had got the tag team championships. I keep having these things pop up on the screen.
Oh yeah.
No problem. That was considered like the developmental. The NXT was back then when we got the belts the first time, me and Harper, Brody Lee. And then again at WrestleMania, was it 34?
I recall correct. And that was for the Raw tag team belts, right?
No, that was
SmackDown.
SmackDown with Usos and New Day. So yes, that was a really cool moment just because me and him had worked. So, you know, we had come together, we had separated, we came together so many times that to finally get a moment at WrestleMania, which we were both looking for, because we both wanted to do single stuff, but we kept finding our way back to each other. And that run with the Bludgeon Brothers, because we didn't always get along. We were always, you know, competing against each other, I think, kind of thing. And they kind of just kept throwing us back together. So they made us room together. He had a problem with my snoring, a lot of stuff like that. So we started really gelling as the Bludgeon Brothers, basically because we had come to the conclusion like, hey, we're in this together. If we want to make it work, it's going to have to be together. So we started listening to both people's ideas, and everything just gelled right. And that was probably
I really liked the Bludgeon Brothers. Stint of time. I think that would fit you guys really well as a wrestling fan. I really enjoyed watching it. Yeah. I think it was one of the more definitive, I think, ways they could have plotted you guys together. You know, it was very nice.
I'd say my two favorite times with the WWE was the tag team, the Bludgeon Brothers with Harper, and doing the singles stuff with Brian and Roman that I had a chance to talk, and no one had heard me speak, and it was great to be able to just start to be myself. I was wearing metal shirts, I'm a big metal fan, and just be me, and
just kind of be able to expose your character a bit more as yourself, so to say.
Expose me and be me. I thought I was hitting a stride. For a second, I got back with Harper, but then they moved me to Raw, and then after that, I had a cage, and I wasn't speaking no more, and I just kind of regressed. And
yeah. How did you? If I could ask, what was your take on the whole cage thing? Did you like it? Were you?
No comments. It was my job.
Yep.
I'd love to get something juicy, but
yeah.
Honestly, when you work in a job, especially a multi-million-dollar company, what they tell you to do is your job, and you try to make it to work the best you can, and you give it your all, and that's what I do. And I'm a professional, and that's what I do. And as far as like, was it the best time I had doing wrestling? No. But like I mentioned, the Bludgeon Brothers stuff and just opening up and being my own person and talking as me and changing my wardrobe a little bit to stuff I would feel comfortable wearing outside of like, I mean, who's comfortable in when they're told they gotta wear, walk out to the ring with a mallet and, you know,
How heavy was that thing? Was it as heavy as it looked? It looked
so
pretty heavy.
My buddy Jason Baker, he works with Tom Savini with the FX department. So he worked with all my masks and all that. So we got him to help us build these hammers, and these hammers were a good, you know, 40 pounds, like solid wood. You swung them at somebody, and if it hit them, it'd take their head off. People thought they were foam for some reason, which I find funny. I have actually one of them. My son's room I keep up and by his desk, which he thinks is cool, but you pick up the thing and it's heavy as hell. But yeah, man, that's probably the two coolest things that happened when I was up there. And it leaves me optimistic just about the future. And you're like giving me memories about stuff that, you know,
certainly, because
things I still want to do in the wrestling business, and it has nothing to do with whether it's WWE or just being able to wrestle in front of fans in any capacity. Like, I'm not done. Not that long shot. Like, wrestling is what I do. It's what I'm best at, and I want to show people what I can do to the full capacity. And they may only get slivers because that's what's written in storylines, but there's so many great people within that company, within all of wrestling, that have so much to show. And, you know, there's a lot of very talented people, and there's a lot of okay talent, but
yeah,
I would never get into that sort of stuff just because where does that leave anybody?
In times
like this, positivity is key. And if you have yourselves, you know, with negative thoughts, it's never good for anybody. And like, I could sit home and be negative because, you know, like I said over and over again, all these people are affected, not being able to work, and they're home not knowing what to do, and they're getting scared because, like, how much money do people have saved up? You know, most people live paycheck to paycheck. And what are they going to do next? And how are they going to make money? And how can you support them? And there's a lot of people that are having difficulties setting up GoFundMe pages, and they're trying to get help. And if you have the means to help them, help them. And if you don't,
even yourself, just sharing a link here and there, you know, would help someone, mm-hmm. you know, to some relief or
exactly.
Just, again, it's not just the entertainment industry that's taking a huge hit. You know, it's every industry. Everyone. I'd say outside.
Across the board.
What would you say to someone that's having a hard time staying positive through all this, Joe?
Smile.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard
to get mad when you're smiling.
It's hard. Like, people are going to be losing their houses soon. You know, people are going to be losing their savings. They're like, you know, I have family that's digging into their savings accounts to try to keep ends meet, you know, and I know people that have, that want to retire that can't retire because all this is, you know, taking out their 401k, and it really sucks. And like, you try to stay positive and try to say we're going to get through this, and
yeah, you gotta
have some sort of optimism, because if you don't have the optimism and you're just negative about things, then nothing good is gonna come. Like, I always learned, if somebody, this especially back with where you know, when I was working with WWE, there'd be people backstage that were the most negative people, upset all the time, but they wouldn't bottle up with themselves and have a smile outside. If you need to have that smile, because people feed off of that stuff, and if they see somebody being grumpy all the time, that person's going to remain grumpy. Being grumpy and being pissed off and placing blame on people is not going to get anybody anywhere. You have to have, you know, a healthy optimism about everything. You have to know that there's always something else out there for somebody. And you know, you can, this is the time to look at other avenues and do other different things that you wouldn't expect, you know?
Yeah, this is actually, in this downtime, that's actually what kind of made me put this show together. I was just kind of talking around with Kyle, and you know, now it's blossomed into this, and something I'd never ventured down before quarantine, you know.
Oh, you had a goblin.
Yeah.
Oh, quick shout out to Amy for the $11.11 donation.
Oh, cool.
To the stream.
Shout out. Awesome. Thanks, Twitch. This is also new. I'm new on Twitch. That's another thing I picked up during quarantine. I've never really done streaming or stuff like this.
Well, thank you to Amy for helping out their Twitch stream.
Yeah, certainly.
Appreciate it.
Let's see. Another good question I wanted to ask. What would any advice would you give to any up and coming wrestlers that are, you know, currently in the indies or want to be in the indies, or that may not even know what the indie leagues are? You know?
Don't start now.
Yeah.
My advice is, and I said this earlier tonight, it's like, don't have an ego. Don't think you're going to be the best of all time. Don't think you are the best of all time. Just be open to learning, like any sport. Like, nobody likes somebody that gloats. Just because you're a natural talent doesn't make you the best thing in the world. Just because you're booked a certain way doesn't make you the best thing in the world. You want to have respect of your peers, especially within wrestling. Nobody wants to work with somebody that's an egomaniac. And I'm sure that happens in the music industry. Nobody wants to work with that musician that's like a total diva. That's, you know, oh, give me this mic. It's not clean. Here, clean this mic. Come over to me. You're not a person, you know?
Yeah, like, yeah.
Everyone wants to be treated good, from the stagehands to, you know, the people that put the ring together, stuff like that. So my advice is never think you're too big for your shoes, kind of thing. Like, always be respectful, humbled, treat people with respect and you'll get it back, but always try to get better. The minute you stop trying to get better is the minute that you're that egotistical, as I say, prick.
Yeah, you know, like you were saying even earlier, yeah, that definitely happens in the music industry as well, and It's something no one wants to be around, you know, no matter what industry, job, you know, even just day-to-day life basis. You know, there's a lot of stuff like that you want to avoid.
No matter what job you do, you can always get better. You can always be better at your job.
Yeah, certainly. It doesn't really matter which. Another good question that I saw, what have you been doing with your time? I know that you said you've been, you know, spending a lot more time at home, which is new for you, especially due to your lifestyle. But is there any new hobbies, knickknacks, anything you've been picking up lately?
I mean, I've been playing some video games with the kid. That Star Wars Battlefront 2. He's got me hooked on, so it's pretty addicting. I'm not like a huge gamer, so I'm not always playing all the time, but it's definitely fun to dabble in. You know, just watching. I've been getting into Curb Your Enthusiasm. You ever see that show?
Oh hell yeah!
Oh yeah!
It's like 10 seasons, so like I'm on the season 7 finally. It's taking me forever, but yeah, that Larry David's a hilarious dude. Always complaining about something. I love that show. And then as far as like other hobbies, like I got nothing on my time but to work out right now. So you know, trying to build myself a little home gym so I never have to go to the gym again.
But yeah, that would be nice. It's always nice to have, you know, some good benches at home.
Yeah, the good thing is it's almost done, so I can stop driving 30 minutes out to my buddy's house to work out in his pole barn.
Yeah,
it's always weird to go to a friend's house when you can't actually see your friend too. So you're like, you're driving all else way to use this gym, and it's like, all right, I'll wipe up, I'll clean up, thanks. Just drive by the house and wave.
Yeah, yeah.
In these times, you got to be, you know, socially distant. And you got to be safe.
Certainly. What do you do diet wise, kind of to stay in shape? So on the road,
I'll do a plug right here for Trifecta Systems at Trifecta Systems. You can look them up on Instagram or Twitter. They do meal plan packages. They help me out a lot with meals. RP Nutrition helps me out with when to eat, what to eat, kind of stuff. Kind of makes it kind of foolproof for me.
Yeah, because I know it's always a little bit easier that way.
Yeah, and I might not have a bodybuilder frame, but I work hard for, you know, the build I got. So I'm always, I'm always trying to eat right, healthy. I'm basically the caveman diet, what a caveman would eat, what it grows in the ground or what you can shoot. Like, that's what I'll eat, you know, plus some veggies.
Right.
And, you know, try not to put a lot of shit into my body, and try to be as healthy as I can. And when I'm on the road, you know, working out, you know, there's nothing else to do except for drive to venues and sleep in hotels and work out.
Yeah, it's a lot of the hurry up and wait is what I like to refer to it as.
But right now, I have all the time in the world just to work out and eat right. You know, I think the only device that I have right now is just a little bit of a drink, but
I mean, I don't think that's ever hurt any. Well, I guess I can't say that, but a little drink here and there never hurt anybody. Yeah.
It is a day off of working out today, so treat yourself to a little drink. It's calorie free if you have the straight whiskey, so goes down smooth.
That's true. I actually remember looking that up back. I used to be like really big into the gym, and I was looking up calories for all sorts of cocktails and stuff like that.
Yeah, a buddy of mine.
Don't ever do that.
A buddy of mine got me into the gin and diet tonic water, calorie free. So lots of gin and diet tonics. Yeah, his name's Gareth. He plays in Ale Storm.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys know who of him or have met him. Good dude.
I know who he is. Yeah.
Okay. Hell yeah. Here we go. Shout out to Gareth.
Yeah, very nice. Well, I reckon we have reached towards the end point. I've got to ask again. I know we loosely touched, but for anyone that just is tuning in now or hasn't seen, what's next for Joe?
I am not done wrestling. I'm going to, as I always do, reinvent myself, or maybe just be me and what I wanted to be all along. So I'm very optimistic about the future, and whether the future puts me into wrestling or something else entirely, it's to be seen. But it's obviously it's only been day two of me being, you know, released, and obviously we do have 90-day no complete causes. As far as wrestling, so don't expect me to pop up tomorrow somewhere else. But during this whole COVID-19 virus, which is causing a huge recession in our, you know, our economy. Who knows when stuff will start to get back to a little bit of normalcy, you know? Like, who knows when I can go out to a concert next, you know? Who knows when, yeah, I can go out to the, who knows when I can go out to, like, a bar, a gym, a restaurant, you know? So, just with all those questions, what's next for me is, well, when the world reopens, we'll know. But I'm optimistic, and I know you're trying to be optimistic. You're putting on these Twitch shows now. Like, everyone's trying to be optimistic and just try to move on one day at a time, because the world keeps going, regardless of if everything's shutting down.
Right. You've just got to take it one day at a time and just take it for what it is, I guess.
And if you think you're drinking too much, just stop.
Yeah.
Just switch to water. I mean, there'll be days that I get bored and I just won't have anything to drink, but that's just because I get sick of drinking.
Yeah, certainly.
Tonight I felt like I earned it. So anybody watching, if you thought I drank too much, slurring my words, say I'm sorry. But
no, you're good, dude.
As I say, I'm a grown-ass man, and I think I earned it.
I believe you did as well, man. Well, I want to thank you so much for coming on. I really appreciate it, and I'm sure a lot of people really enjoyed it.
And
appreciate it, man.
And I do keep my promises, and most people don't know I had agreed to do this before I found out I was released. So,
oh yeah,
just so people don't think I was trying to jump onto a podcast and start talking about whatever. No, I agreed to do this with Alex a few weeks prior to this all happening.
Yeah, good. Thank you for bringing that up, actually. I didn't think to mention that.
Got another $5 donation from
very
Rhiannon.
Cool. Very, very awesome. Well, we won't keep you here too long. Thank you again, Joe. You know, I'll be in touch. I'm sure we'll meet up again one of these days once everything's, back in action. I wish you nothing but the best, and I'm very excited to see what the future has in store for you.
For sure. Same to you. Take care of your two tigers, and I cannot wait to see what Kyle
like. You'll see it soon, man. I'll text you over the link to this right when we're done.
All right. Thanks. Oh, yeah. All right. See you guys.
Thanks again.
Take care.